to me instead of go to lunch. I really, really appreciate that. Hopefully the conversation we'll have today will be as satisfying as your lunch. So just to begin, I thought I would just take you through the main ideas that I had for writing the book, the main ideas that are presented, and tell you a little bit more about myself. So the title of the book, as we've discussed, is called Clearly Invisible, Racial Passing and the Color of Cultural Identity. And there's a copy of it. And the question that I like to ask people to think about is, you know, has there ever been a time, or could there be a time right now, when you might be passing? And if that's the case, maybe this book is for you. So this book is definitely for me. It's also kind of about me in a very roundabout way. So that is me. And I am a passer. Though as I began to write the book and think about different people's experiences with passing, I realized that my primary means and form of passing, the primary way that I've accessed success, is not by racial passing, but by age passing. And by passing as older than I actually have been. So this all started long ago, as I explained to Mr. Tucker a couple of weeks ago when we were putting this talk together, back in Brooklyn, New York, where I was a public school student who needed to be in school all day and was only eligible for half-day school in the neighborhood where my parents lived. So in order to get into this better school that would offer me all day and allow me to skip grades and do all these other things which have led me here to talk to you today, I had to pass as older, 2 years older than I was. So entering the first grade at 4 years old and having to realize that there were certain things I could and couldn't do, having the teachers call my parents and say, we think she has a learning disability because she can't hold her pencil correctly, she's not as strong as the other children, are you feeding her enough? And all of these different things. And I remember the anxiety that I felt not being able to let people know that I was really just younger and there were just some things I couldn't do. And so as I began to do the research for this book and do the historical digging and just talk to people about passing today, this common thread of anxiety and not knowing, you know, how to explain certain things and certain limitations that you have really began to shine through. And so that's when I realized, whether we're talking about age or race or geography or education or anything else, right, passing is definitely not passé. And so that's where I start in the book. I say, okay, if passing is not passé, then why have we been trying to label it as such for so long? What are our interests in doing so? And as you'll see as I go through the various examples, I think our interests are many and deep. One of the first is really wanting to say that our society is more egalitarian, right, than it is. And so as we pass, we are allowed to access various privileges, various opportunities, various situations, get away from various constraints to help us do whatever it is we want to do. So if passing is for everybody, if passing is not passé, if I'm going to argue that it's still going on, then I had to figure out, well, where in the world did it start? And so that's what took me back to my classical rhetorical studies. And I began to look at Plato and the Sophists and all of these things that make my students yawn every semester when I have to talk to them, right? But what I began to see was that the history of intercultural and interracial contact in Greece and the way in which we frame how we think about identity, how we think about words like rhetoric, and philosophy comes back to this notion of passing. And so our great friend Plato was confronted with people called the Sophists who had traveled all over the known world at the time, who had access to different forms of communication, who wanted to give people access to those different forms of communication so that they could succeed and survive in his society. And Plato didn't appreciate this. So he said that the Sophists were passers. They were passing as philosophers. They were passing as educators. They were passing as people who really cared about society. Really, they only cared about themselves. And their rhetoric was just propaganda. It was BS, something that we shouldn't be concerned with. And so I took those lessons, I took that way of thinking about identity and thinking about authenticity, and I wanted to apply it to more modern and contemporary ways of thinking about different types of identity here for us in the States. And so that's what led me to my first of many passwords, right? That passing is a form of persuasion in an increasingly diverse world. And so whether it's Plato and the Sophists, or whether it's us today, and we can have that argument when we open it up for question and answer, right? I think that we can think about passing like this. I move on in the book then to apply that concept of passing is a strategy of persuasion, to think about how passing might also be a strategy for empowerment. And so I move on in chapter two of the book to look at Ellen and William Craft. And so for those of you, I'm sure, who know, this is an audience I'm excited to speak to who knows about this, right? This is an enslaved couple from the South in the United States who gave themselves freedom for Christmas, and how they did this was passing. So Ellen, the woman you see here on the left, passed as a wealthy white disabled slave owner, and William, her soon-to-be husband, passed as her slave. And they rode in plain sight, together though in separate cars, unless illness required them to be together in the white car, all the way from Georgia to Philadelphia. It took them 4 days, they were almost outed many, many times, and they become what I call our first version of reality stars, right? So once they get to Philadelphia, and then later to the United Kingdom, where they learn how to read and write, they go all over Europe, the United States, and even to Africa, telling their story to raise money for the movement. And with the money they were able to raise, they were able to free members of their family and buy an estate in Georgia, where they educated slaves, former slaves, and eventually died. So it's a pretty amazing story, but you know, the story of Ellen in particular takes on these extra levels of passing. The way that I'd seen this story told until I decided to look at it a little bit differently from this rhetorical perspective was really just in terms of race only. And I thought, well, that wouldn't have worked, right, if she had just passed as a wealthy white woman. Wealthy white women couldn't travel with the enslaved. Wealthy white women couldn't travel necessarily on their own all the time. So the gender aspect took on extra significance. And then I really ran up against a brick wall when I thought about the disability aspect. And reading the Crafts and thinking about the Crafts made me realize that they were replacing or masquerading one form of disability for another, right? So as we know, the enslaved generally were not allowed to read and write. So in order to get around having to sign her name and William's name at various checkpoints, Ellen pretended that her hand was limp, that she had this disease that had attacked her muscular structure. And so she was able to get people to sign her name for her along the way. So the disability aspect takes on another twist and turn. And then as it got around the train, you know, because as things do, that Ellen was traveling on her own, her name was Mr. Johnson, all of these women started flirting with her. So she would develop like these fever fainting spells, and you know, she'd go deaf suddenly, and William would have to come in, they'd have to call William to attend to her, right? So it was really this brilliant form of masquerading in some sense, right? But also thinking about what it takes to become empowered. And so that led me to my second password of many in the book, right? That passing is the power to change life circumstances. Too often when we think about passing, we think about it as something that people do because they hate themselves, or something that people do because they just don't see any other way, or they may have mental incapacity, which we'll also talk about in a couple of minutes, right? But as I began to talk to contemporary passers and look through the pages of history and rhetorical history, I found that not to be the case at all. So we move from me in Brooklyn to Plato and the Sophist, to Ellen and William Craft and their amazing story. From there, I decided to move on to period after enslavement, though not much after, thinking about the case of Plessy versus Ferguson. So here, instead of passing to get oneself out of slavery, right, we have passing to try to free the masses from racialized segregation. And of course, this backfires miserably, and we then have to think about why, right? There are many reasons why, and the first thought about this I certainly owe to Professor Cheryl Harris from the law school, right, who talks about whiteness as property. And so I began to think then, well, why then did they just come down so hard on Plessy? Why did they not only send him to jail, but fine him and do all of these other things? And I began to realize, to the court and to many who held similar opinions in the day, passing was not a form of empowerment, it was not a form of persuasion, right? It was a form of identity theft. And so I began thinking about how we've thought about identity and identity theft, and looking at how that plays out through the case. And so I say, what if Homer Plessy and his attorneys who abetted him and argued for him on his behalf in court are our first identity thieves? And so I retell and replay the case that way, and then connect it to thinking about issues today in terms of identity theft. So not just all of these, you know, computer hackers that we're told we should be so afraid of, right? but also thinking about today's undocumented immigrants. So we've got Jose Antonio Vargas, who is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, writes for the New York Times and many other publications, who outed himself much in the same way Homer Plessy did 2 years ago, and still isn't sure what's going to happen. Is he going to be deported or not? Has he stolen U.S. identity? And what does this mean in a world in which demographics continue to change? And as I looked at Jose Antonio Vargas, as I thought about identity theft, as I thought about Homer Plessy and Plessy versus Ferguson, I also then realized that, of course, you know, this has never been a story that's been told just in black and white terms, right? We like to tell it that way, but it's always been a full color conversation. And so we see that with Jose Antonio Vargas today and his Filipino Asian American identity. And we see it in the case of Plessy versus Ferguson, where the court tells Plessy, hey, you stole US identity, but all we're going to do is put you in jail and fine you. We're not going to deport you, because who we deport are Chinese. And so I also began to think about what Asian American identities mean in the process of passing, and how black and white and multiracial identities have always been operating in the shadow of Asian American identities as well. So that's Plessy versus Ferguson, and thinking about how passing can be a way of turning identity into property, or, depending on who you talk to, identity theft. So I move on from there then, and thinking, okay, if passing can be identity theft, a form of gaining freedom, a way to get a better education, a way to persuade people to hear your case, what happens when we take it to the fictional world? And so I looked at the story called Iola Leroy, or Shadows Uplifted, written by Frances E.W. Harper. This was her rhetorical argument, her rhetorical meditation on the Plessy versus Ferguson ruling. She, like so many at the time, black, white, Asian, and other, were very upset by this ruling. And so she wanted to think about a way to imagine using passing as a form of empowerment to uplift and for social justice. So in her story, she has these twins, Harry and Iola, who grow up white. They live in the South, they're on a plantation. That's the world they know. They get sent to the fanciest boarding schools in the Northeast, where they're defending slavery and talking about how they treat slaves like their own family and how great that is, until they get called home because their father's died, and it turns out they're black. Their mother was enslaved. She and her father fell in love as they were both learning how to read as children. He bought her her freedom. They started a family and kept the secret that mom was passing, and therefore the family and children were passing. So these twins now get home. Iola gets home, and she's like, oh my goodness, I have to save my brother from this. He got the news a few days later. So thinking about the crafts and thinking about the power of literacy and what the crafts didn't have, Iola is able to warn her brother by sending him a letter saying, you know, don't come home. I'll find you at some point later. Here's what's going on. And one of the comments Iola makes after she's able to get this letter off is how angry she is, not because this new truth about her racial identity has been found out, that she's black or mixed or now enslaved or however we want to describe it, but that her legacy, her material property, her right to education, her right to her father's inheritance, her right to own property has all been taken from her because she's now been moved into this alternate category. And so the story is what happens both to Iola and to her brother as they have to reckon with this choice. And it's fascinating. So, you know, it turns out very differently on the basis of gender. It's like a total soap opera. So as you can see, I like my reality TV and soap opera frames for all of this. But to make the long story short, Harry decides that his way to fight back and to try to free his sister and his mom is to join the Union Army. But he's then confronted with the decision to join a colored or a white regiment. And he agonizes over this, and he doesn't know what to do. And finally, he decides that he's going to what he calls pass as black in order to join the colored regiment and have a better chance because of the social networks to find his family who's now been enslaved. And so it's the course that his life takes over time through that. And he falls in love with this beautiful African-American woman named Miss Delaney, and they decide after many years of dating to go down to the South after they found Iola and, you know, heard about her whole story, which I'll tell you in a moment. And so they're on the train going from the Northeast to the South, And he, Harry, has to keep switching cars depending on where they are, because in some places he's white, in other places he's not. And so while his soon-to-be wife gets to stay in one place, he begins, you know, to say, isn't this ridiculous, right? That I could be too black to be white in New Jersey, right? And too white to be black in Georgia. Maybe I should just wear a sign, right? And so it's, you know, so many of these instances that happen to him. For his sister, she is enslaved and then freed and becomes a nurse. And she has this choice. Who is she going to be with? Is she going to be, you know, with the wealthy, handsome, George Clooney-ish, you know, style Dr. Latimer, right? Or is she going to be with the man she eventually chooses, who's also had this experience of growing up white and then being multiracial, another doctor? And how are they going to make it work? She chooses the latter. And the story unfolds from there. So this became Harper's calling card, this story, her retort to the Supreme Court in a world where she had no other voice. And as she began to do lectures like this, and even more grand, because she was one of the first African-American women to write such a book that was well received, she herself, Frances Harper, was accused of passing. How? Either she was white or a male. Because no woman of color could write such a story like this. No woman of color could be so eloquent. And the arguments that were leveraged against her were the same as the arguments that were leveled by Plato against the sophists, right? You can't possibly have had access to this information. You don't deserve to be here. So you must not be who you say you are. And so, as we've seen in news reports this week, this argument keeps coming up again and again and again for people of color from all walks of life. And where it starts, right, is with Plato and the sophists, at least if you're a rhetoric geek like me. So for Frances Harper then, passing was so much more than it became for anyone else I've told you about today, because it became a form of principled action. There was a way to find a community of common interest, a way to see the power relations going on in society, and also a way to make a difference. It was also a way to make an argument and a way to respond to a society that was not giving you a fair chance. So hardly the mental health case that we usually think of for passers. And then to the 21st century. I talk about The Human Stain. I don't know if any of you have seen this film or read the book. They are both brilliant. A little gossip moment on the novel is that just last month in The New Yorker, Philip Roth, the author, a Jewish-American author, was writing about what the story was really about, which is the phenomenon of passing. And he wanted to go to the Wikipedia page and correct, because people keep saying this is about Anatole Goyard, this is about this, this is about so-and-so and so-and-so and so-and-so, trying to out various people. And Roth said, no, it's just a story that I'd heard about that I decided to take creative license with that has nothing to do with Mr. Broyard or his family. And Wikipedia said, that's great, but we're not going to let you update the page. You need a source to cite. And he wrote back, I am the source to cite. And hence he took his case to The New Yorker, right? So here, even the author, again, just in the case with Frances Harper, right, his authority is questioned based upon who he is as a Jewish American. So that's the story that Roth begins to tell in the novel and the film. And so what I look at here, and this is one of my favorite shots because it really, in terms of direction and just power struggle and the boxing metaphor is so deep here, really makes us think about what passing entailed, that it was something that leaves a stain, no matter how successful the outcomes might have been. And so what I look at in the book then is not to retell the story that Roth told, because I don't think I could do it any better, but rather to look at how differently the book and the film were received. So the book won all types of awards. It was controversial, but in a great way. Nearly 10 years later, we're still talking about it in The New Yorker. It was an amazing, amazing book. The movie, however, was completely panned, even though it had the likes of Wentworth Miller, it had the likes of Anthony Hopkins, Nicole Kidman, and a host of other very well-known and talented actors and actresses. The film was completely panned. And I wanted to figure out why. Did they really change the story that much? I got a copy of the script of the film. No, right? I saw the film. No, the story was really the same. Okay, did Philip Roth not have input? So was he complaining about the film? No, he had input. In fact, he wrote many of the new scenes for the film that differ from the books. Okay, so it still has authority and integrity there. What's the difference? Why was the film so hated? And I finally realized what it was. It was because we could see the passer, and that this was really disturbing, right? To see someone that starts out looking like this gentleman here and winds up, you know, later on in life looking something like Anthony Hopkins freaked a lot of people out. And they said that a racial passer couldn't look that way. A racial passer couldn't possibly present us with this appearance. And so we can't possibly believe that Anthony Hopkins could play this role with any form of integrity. Consequently, Wentworth Miller, who actually is half black and half white, you know, he was convincing, the critics said, in terms of thinking about someone who was confused about race. But he can't really be from an African-American family. Maybe he could be Jewish, but I don't think so, right? And so for both of these two actors then, who they were, it's the same story again, right? Who they were was questioned. And because we were confronted as audiences with these images of what passers probably actually looked at if they were able to maintain this for 5 or 6 decades, like the protagonists in this film and book, audiences didn't want to see that, right? So we loved it in the book, I propose, because we could imagine this person however we thought he could look. And at some point, he would be out, right? But in the film, we don't get that luxury, and we're forced to deal with the messiness of these rhetorical and social constructions of race. So that's the human stain, where passing is a pastime, it is a form of entertainment, that also leaves a stain behind it, both for audiences who enjoy the artifacts, as well as for the characters who tell us the stories. And from this study, actually, I'm working on a study of 100 blockbuster films since the 1950s that involve passing in some form or another, whether it's race, class, age, gender, sexual orientation, religion, and looking for similarities and differences in terms of the critiques that the films face. And it's pretty interesting and pretty profound what films get celebrated and what don't based on what type of passing happens. And we can talk more about that later on. And finally, to the second decade of the 21st century, and probably to what I think is the most poignant story of passing in the book, the case of Leo V. Felton. Are any of you familiar with this gentleman? Okay, so Leo Felton is currently in prison for the rest of his life right now in Massachusetts. He is a raging white supremacist. He was arrested on a domestic terrorist plot that he almost pulled off in Boston in 2002. He was targeting prominent Jewish and African-American citizens there, and hopefully, he hoped, all throughout the East Coast. How was he caught? Ironically, he was caught passing off counterfeit money at a Dunkin' Donuts where a police officer happened to be taking his break, right? So stereotypical and ironic as it is, that's how he was caught. So when the police officer brings him in to jail, the police officer's like, what in the world is this? I have a stack of arrest warrants for the person with these fingerprints, but they all have a different race on them. What do you mean he's Jewish? What do you mean he's black? What do you mean he's other? He's a domestic terrorist. He's not Jewish or black. He wants to kill Jewish and African Americans. And so the story comes out that his mother is Jewish American, his father is African American, and Leo Felton has become a raging white supremacist. And so he makes very interesting arguments as his trial goes on. One of them is that if race is this symbolic thing, if it's this social construction that we know it to be, why then can't I be a white supremacist just because of who my parents are and how they identify? Can't I identify in any way I so choose, even if that disturbs somebody else? Compelling until he falls back to, well, I'm going to target people who I think look Jewish and African American, or I think are Jewish and African American because of what I think those identities represent, right? So he doesn't give people the luxury that he gives to himself. Nevertheless, I think he forces us to think about the paradoxes of race, the paradoxes of multiracial identities in a world where demographics are changing so quickly and brilliantly. And so I begin with thinking about how Leo Felton was framed. He was framed not so much as a terrorist, which I thought was really interesting. That narrative was not available because he was of Jewish background in mainstream press, right? So what could he be? He was a mental case. And And so when he's covered in the New York Times, the Boston Globe, the Washington Post, it's always under the mental health sections of their magazines. When he's interviewed, people always want to know about his family. You know, they talk to members of his family, and you know, he was, you know, we knew he was troubled, but Leo's really a good boy. How could all of this really happen? And so what this forces us to think about is that people of various racial identities, and particularly multiracial identities, can be raging white supremacists, and that multiracial identities can be leveraged for a neoconservative agenda that is really not necessarily healthy for society. So I talk also about Sarah Palin in that chapter and how she tried to leverage a multiracial identity in 2008 to 2010 to really make it big. And how that flopped, but it was interesting nevertheless, right? But also then to think more about passing and multiracial identities today and how they present us with a paradox that exposes both the realities and the fictions of race, to quote one of my favorite anthropologists, John L. Jackson, right? So that's the story of passing that I wanted to tell, the story of passing that involves someone as troubled and troubling as Leo Felton, because it's really, for me, the whole story of passing, right? We often think of passing as I said, something people do because they hate themselves, something people do because they hate society. But we don't necessarily think of passing in the ways that I've described it here, as this challenge to courts, challenge to institutions like enslavement or citizenship and immigration policies today, challenges to technology when we think about hacktivism, and I'll tell you about one of my favorite online passers during question and answer as well. So as we get back to it then, in the conclusion of the book, I ask whether passing can be a form or a pathway to progress, right? And I leave that as a question, because I think the answer is still yet to be determined. I think we have to look to online and alternate reality spaces to begin to have a more holistic answer to this question for the 21st century and beyond. We have to even think about McDonald's, right, and their comment about passing, right, that no one should do it. So the question then is, if the answer, at least until our conversation today, has been that nobody should pass, my question is why? Why has that always been the answer? And I think the answer is it because when we pass, we allow society to pass as well. But when we stop passing, or when we tell our stories about passing, like the characters that I've told you about today do, we create moments for honest conversation about racial, gender, sexual orientation, religious, as well as technologized, if that's even a word, identities, and how they continue to operate today. So I again say that I leave the question open, just as I started with the question, you know, are you passing? Have you ever passed, right? I leave the book with a question as well. Well, what does passing mean, and can we imagine it as a pathway to progress? And if so, what would that look like? So that's the book in a nutshell, and that's what it looks like. I've got t-shirts and mugs as well, just for marketing and promotional purposes, right? But you know, the idea behind the title was really to remind us that to pass is to be clearly invisible, right? And to get us to think about how we and so many people we communicate with on a daily basis might be engaging in this form of clear invisibility. So with that, I'll stop talking, and I'll open it up for questions and answers and see where the conversation takes us, if that's okay. Great. Thank you so much for having me.
Marcia, yes. I'm still trying to figure out exactly how to frame the question, but the essence of it is this. There was a lot of talk back in I guess 2008 when Obama was elected, mm-hmm. about the authenticity of his racial identity. And there were reports, at least, that some in the black community questioned whether he was really black. You know, and a lot of people argued that, well, Michelle sealed the deal for me, that, you know, she's clearly African American, and so therefore I assume that he is as well. And then there were others who kind of speculated that the larger electorate, particularly in places like Iowa, you know, sort of projected this whole other sort of racial identity onto Obama because of the unique attributes of this biography that allowed him to be something other than what he might otherwise be seen as in terms of race. And of course, once he gets into office, you have a number of very public attacks on his character that seem more consistent with him being raised as African American. I'm thinking of cases in Congress when people openly call him a liar during the State of the Union address and things like that that don't typically happen to white presidents.
Right.
I'm just wondering if your framework of passing and the relationship of passing to the structures of race apply in this situation, which seems to be a bit extraordinary as it relates to the presidency and the identity of the president.
It does in many different ways. So Obama came up in this book for me, not as a chapter, but almost as an undertow throughout every single chapter, thinking about all these incidents and so many more that we could raise. And so I began thinking about how he was marketed in different places in different ways during the 2008 election. So if you were in Kansas, as I was for a conference, about this time 4 years ago, you would see commercials for Obama using his voice, quoting clips from his autobiography with no visual references to Obama. It would be his grandfather riding a tractor or his grandmother doing some work around the house, right? And then if you were in other places, you would see, you know, the same narration with completely different images with, you know, who we know to be the president, could be with or without Mrs. Obama and the girls, depending on what he was trying to do. So I would say that President Obama, at least the way his public image campaign was run the first time, was definitely highly interpretive of the framework of passing and multiracial identities and what they can and can't do, for better or worse. I think we've seen, now that he has become president and obviously is running again, we see that leverage the other way. So there was a great book released late last year. It was by what has been found out later to be this quack psychiatrist. The book is called Obama on the Couch, okay? The guy has never had Obama on the couch, but nevertheless writes like a 250-page book, which I, you know, decided to read. About the president. It talks about really how, you know, much of what we might interpret as the president's indecisiveness or inability to lead, or what we could interpret during, for instance, the first debate performance, is this kind of cool, relaxed demeanor that doesn't want to necessarily take one side or another, you know, too hard, is because he's multiracial and he doesn't really know where to go anyway and doesn't really know where to find a home. So it all comes back to this pathology for multiracials that we have, that they're, you know, these tragic mulattoes who either hate themselves or hate everybody else. There's really only two ways out of that. And so, you know, we begin to see that. Then there was the book earlier this summer that, you know, talks about Obama is going to New York to really find himself as an African American, but then dating white women and saying, I don't really feel black. And so I'm going to go to Harlem and try to feel black. And apparently that doesn't work out well for the president and all of these different things, right? So, so that's my long, I think, yes to your question. But also then we have to think about how Obama has responded to this. So in the first installment of his autobiography, he talks about how, while he is multiracial and claims all aspects of his identity in a personal sense, he also understands how he presents to society, how he's going to be treated based on that presentation, and therefore has chosen to identify as black on the census. Because he also understands what the census is designed to do.
The political dimension.
Exactly. Yeah. And so this really upsets people as part of the multiracial movement who say, you know, he's denying this other side of his heritage. And Obama has retorted, you know, well, to be black in America is to always already be multiracial. We just don't want to talk about it. He said that on The View, right? That to be black in America is always to be a mutt. Right, and it probably is the same case for white people. We just have chosen not to discuss it that way. So, you know, he has responded back, but it's been interesting in the forms in which he has responded, The View and the census, and not in the speech on race. That, you know, so I think he's using this strategy of passing as persuasion in a very diverse world, this more sophisticated, old school original sense of passing in that way. Because, I mean, if nothing else, politics aside, I think he's a brilliant communicator. Mm-hmm. And he has had these experiences of having to be persuaded and learn how to persuade people from all over the world. Mm-hmm. And so I think it comes to bear now.
You mentioned Sarah Palin.
Oh, yes. Oh, well, this was when she and the Tea Party back 2 years ago were accused of being racists. And, you know, not liking President Obama and the like. So she was like, well, first of all, you know, not true. And let me tell you why I can't be a racist. Because I'm married to an Eskimo. And so we have these multiracial children, and we live in this melting pot called Alaska, which if you read the census and take it as it is one of our most diverse areas. Right? So it was a very pointed rhetorical strategy. So because I have this in my family, and I live in this area with people from, you know, very diverse walks of life, I'm not racist, and because I have this diverse family, and I'm diverse, and I live in this diverse place, and I represent the Tea Party can't be racist either. And besides, don't you know Obama's multiracial too? And multiracial people can't be biased against multiracial people. I just don't like his politics, right? So she used this multiracial identity to completely sidestep the issue of racism. And she's not the first one to do this either. I mean, Newt Gingrich was great at this. Like, he wanted them to pass the Tiger Woods bill, which even Tiger Woods opposed after he came out with the Cobblination term in 1997 on Oprah. Newt Gingrich said, you see, he's a Cobblination. He's living in a technicolor world, not this black and white stuff. We don't have a need for racial categories anymore. And Tiger Woods was like, that's not what I was saying at all. I was saying that we need to trouble the concept of race and allow it to be troubled probably for a long time. Right, so it's this history that people have on the right with using these multiracial identities as a way to say, we can't be racist, and by the way, didn't you know racism was over anyway? We have Sarah Palin, we have Obama, we have Tiger Woods, right? So it's pretty interesting, and some of the stories I'm looking at now in my new work, my next book is about Eminem and his cultural significance, right? And one of the things I found out about Eminem, which speaks to passing in our political election as well with Elizabeth Warren in Massachusetts and how she can't possibly be Native American because Scott Brown knows what Native American people look like and they don't look like Elizabeth Warren. It's come out through the research that Eminem has also been passing as white, right? That he also has Native American ancestry, but he realized that he didn't want to have to deal with that coming up in the genre of hip hop, that believe it or not, it was easier to be different because of being white than it was to be different because of being Native American and white in the land of hip hop. And so what does that mean that our foremost contemporary white rapper is actually passing as white, right? This is happening consistently. And it's we have to be careful with how it gets used. And that's why, can it be a form of progress? Some people can use it to tell us that we've progressed beyond race. But others, like Eminem, for instance, tell us, well, wait a minute. Maybe we haven't gotten beyond race at all.
Any other questions?
There's another one percolating.
One
second.
It's cool.
When I hear you talk, I think of work I've seen in cultural studies and other fields that talk about strategic essentialism. Mm-hmm. And so this whole idea of sort of on the one hand recognizing the fallacy of race, recognizing that it is a fiction, that it is a social construction, but on the other hand seeing the utility of affirming race in certain circumstances to forward political agendas, mm-hmm. like an anti-racist politics, for example,
sure.
that ironically has to use race and
right.
racial.
Absolutely.
And so how do you, and of course that kind of maps on to this whole debate about the multiracial category and multiracial Americans wanting to have their various identities recognized and affirmed against other more traditional groups wanting not to have their numbers diluted. Mm-hmm. And so again, it boils down to politics, mm-hmm. typically in a society that has been traditionally and historically racist. So I'm just curious, in terms of thinking of the way you're framing passing in the book and with the examples you give, how does all of this fit into kind of the political kind of contest that is raging? I mean, because you've given lots of examples of how neoconservatives and conservatives are kind of using or taking advantage of demographic diversity to essentially argue against everything that supports diversity. How do you see the the passing phenomenon kind of playing into that?
Sure. Well, I'll answer that with two examples. The first is my favorite passer of the moment, even more favorite than Eminem, which is Mitt Romney. Right. So we've
right.
got so, we, right. so we've yeah. got this right. guy who's a Mexican immigrant, kind of Christian,
kind of Mormon,
yeah. kind of not part of the 1%, but definitely kind of part of the 1%, right? And trying to negotiate and leverage these identities, and fails masterfully at this all the time, right? But what's interesting to me about somebody like Mitt Romney in this instance is that he's giving us a back door into how delicate, cunning, wise, and strategic passers have had to be, whether it's about race or age or any of these things that we've talked about today, and how passing fails so miserably when those things are not, when those qualities and skills are not operating, right? So that's one way in which passing is failing miserably today. Where passing may be succeeding a little bit more is with the question of multiracial identities and the census. And so we have, at the very least, three camps on this issue. So there is the one camp, the Newt Gingrich camp, who took Tiger Woods' Coblin Asian statement and said, okay, we can argue for one multiracial category on the census for everybody who chooses not to be boxed into any one of these traditional categories. So if you're, you know, Cuban and Chinese, or African-American and Irish-American, you get to check this multiracial box. Well, that's meaningless, right? But that's option one. Option two is kind of what we got in 2000, which is you can check all that apply. However, this is what I call the Wizard of Oz moment, right? When we check all that apply, what happens? We get lumped behind the scenes right back into those categories that people were fighting to burst out of originally, right? So whatever's more needed in that area is what you or I would become if we checked two or more boxes in 2000 and also in 2010. The third option is to get rid of race altogether, which a lot of people are using the explosion of new births in 2010 and 2011, the first non-white majority generation born in the United States. And so using that in order to say, well, hey, this is going to change anyway, we might as well get rid of it now, these kids are going to see it differently. So let's just not have them grow up in a world where this is an issue, right? So that's kind of from coming down from the top down. From the bottom up, you get what I call the three A's. So from multiracial communities that I've interviewed and researched, you get the first A, the need for acknowledgement. The need for acknowledgement that multiracial identities are not new. We've decided to make them new now for political gain, and that means we have to deal with history. That's when I talk to people of various multiracial backgrounds. That's the first thing that they say. Like, I'm not new, I'm not a fad, even though you'll see, you know, racially ambiguous people to sell you anything from like Geico insurance now to Subarus and soap, right? The second A is, you know, appreciation of what they call the mixed experience or the mixed mindset, right? Which is that we struggle with this paradox, you know. Is it more expedient to be African American? Why has it been more expedient, for instance, to be African American? Why is the president choosing to do so? And as a person who, you know, theoretically should support everybody's right to identify as he or she chooses, how do I support that even if I don't agree with it? It's a lot of things that multiracials are saying, right? And those answers aren't getting well received back within politics. Where they are getting well received is in advertising and entertainment. Mm-hmm. So this is where I was going to have some clips for you. But any of you who like music and like Dr. Dre's Beats headphones, you'll see Dr. Dre, surprise, surprise, he's behind Eminem in the first place, is on top of this, right? So his whole marketing campaign to sell his headphones is, you get to choose your color. You get to choose to be yourself. You wear my headphones, you can be purple, green, orange, whatever, united colors of Beats headphones. And now his headphones are the number one headphones sold basically across the world, right? You get L'Oreal and Beyonce responding to this. So now Beyonce is African American, French, and Native American. She's gonna sell us our true match for cosmetics, right? So, you know, where multiracial questions are being ignored politically or used in this way, that actually takes us back, to quote my dad, right? In advertising and entertainment, we see it potentially doing something different. And so there is no answer. That's why I end the book with a question. Mm-hmm. There is no answer yet you know, to that. And then when we take it a step further and think about alternate realities, now people pass on Facebook and Twitter and Google Plus and Pinterest, and you know, one of my favorite passes is on Pinterest. Pinterest is this visual-only social media site that came up about a year or two ago. And this one guy was an early adopter. Pinterest, you should also know, is heavily skewed to women. So you can, you know, post, you know, your favorite outfit, your favorite recipe, this type of thing. So this gentleman was a savvy marketer and decided that he would create this online persona that would do this, and he would, you know, post all of this, but passing as a woman. So he got a picture of a beautiful woman. He made up this whole narrative in his bio about a woman, and he was one of the first people to use Pinterest to make tons and tons of money. He created a business model out of this, right? But it's gender passing. It's online passing. It's mediated passing. And so, where I think, you know, passing, as I've talked about it at least today with these examples, sheds some light, right, is to remind us that this world that they tell us we live in that's all about authenticity and transparency has actually never been the case, and that we need to think rather about how we can be sincere in our identities and how we can have sincere political commitments, not necessarily based on who we look like, right, but what we really believe. So it's still left, at least from my estimation, to be determined whether politics is going to give us that answer or advertisers. Mm-hmm. Sadly, I think my money is on the advertisers. Mm-hmm. And so then that opens up a whole new issue of citizen consumption that we need to begin to think about. Yeah?
Just a small note about Mitt Romney.
Yeah?
I have a friend who's Mexican-American, and she has family members that she has to convince about Romney not being Mexican.
Mm-hmm.
Because his relative fluency mm-hmm. in Spanish
mm-hmm.
does, I'm not saying it's widespread.
Gotcha.
But
well, and I mean, and you can read in the newspapers, I mean, I've read about that there is a segment, right, of Latino communities who have decided to interpret Romney's identity in that way, and they have the right to do that. Certainly his sons help him with that, being fluent in Spanish and courting Latino communities in that way. But you know, the answer at the end of the day is, for me, when it comes to a question of immigration, and Mitt Romney says something like self-deportation, okay, you know, how then would that have played out in your own family history? And as long as you could be honest about that, I'm cool with it. And he, from my estimation, has not chosen to take the second step so far. So again, it's not being Mexican-American or not. It's not being Latino or not. It's being sincere with whatever your political ideas. And he hasn't, for many, demonstrated that sincerity.
Yeah, and the sense is rather would choose white.
One would imagine. We'll have mm-hmm. to, if he gets elected, I guess we'll find, well, we may not.
We may not, yeah.
Yeah.
But whether you're black and white, black, Mexican, black, Asian, black, whatever, you have to be, you're black.
Well, that's how it's been since Plessy versus Ferguson, right? The rule of hypo descent. In fact, interestingly, to the 2010 census, the largest growing multiracial group is Asian black.
Mm-hmm.
So again, thinking back to the fact that as we've constructed it in law, you know, these multiracial identities have always involved Asian and Asian American identities. You're exactly right. You need to keep thinking about what that means and why people are choosing these particular categories. You know, it's fascinating. I remember having the census folks come to my house when we were kids. So my mom is, Cuban and also has Middle Eastern ancestry, right? So, you know, communist terrorist was always a joke in our house. And my dad is African American, and also we've come to find out later on multiracial. And so, you know, it was always really tough because my parents wanted us to be counted, you know, in these different categories as a family. And before 2000, certainly, you know, they'd basically be like, well, I'll take your word for it that you're Latino, but you really look white to me, but I'll count your family as Latino because that's what the mother is, and I'm out of here, right? And so every time the census folks would come, like, my mom would make tea, and it would be this whole thing, and my sister and I would just sit there like, why do we have to sit there and listen to this? Again, just like we did 10 years ago, right? But, you know, obviously it sank in because now I'm interested in it myself. Other questions, comments?
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having me.
Also, if you would like to read more about this,
office. James Messelon, of course, is selling copies of the book, and if you really want to wear a mug or t-shirt.
Yes, you can go to the website, clearlyinvisiblebook.com. I'll give everybody a postcard so they can do that as well.
Thank you.
Sure.
Oh, Alice, you want to make a plug for the event tonight?
No, you can't, Doctor.
For those